God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard Hardin can now be heard Monday through Friday mornings at 7 a.m. Central, 8 Eastern, and on Sunday mornings at 6 a.m. Central, 7 Eastern. Join him and let's turn our country back to God. It only takes a spark to start a forest fire. Let's get on fire for the Lord, right here on K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network. K98 Talk is expanding its lineup for 2015. This means we are expanding our advertising base. Whether you're a startup trying to push through to the next level, or an established business trying to supplement your advertising budget, web-based advertising is a solid investment. Thanks to Talk's newest partnership with TuneIn Radio and instant access to our sister station, K98 FM, we give you worldwide access at a reasonable cost. Interested parties should email us at advertise@k98talk.org.
For past programs of God's Pure Word of Faith, go to www.spreaker.com. That's Spreaker, spreaker.com. In the search box at the top of the page, enter my name, Richard Hardin, H-A-R-D-I-N, and click on it. A picture with a cross and God's Pure Word of Faith, Richard Hardin, will show up. Click on the picture of the cross. A listing of all the past programs will then show up.
Visit Richard's website at rahardin.com. That's the World Wide Web at rahardin.com. At his website, you can see a summary of the 6 books he has written, where purchases may be made. He also has a link to 18 videos on YouTube and several blogs about Christian beliefs. If you prefer, visit amazon.com/Kindle and type in Richard Hardin to see and purchase his books. You're listening to God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard Hardin. Richard will guide you through the Bible and help you find God's purpose for your life. Now here's teacher and author Richard Hardin.
Welcome to God's Pure Word of Faith again. And again, I want to thank the Lord and the management of K98 Talk for this great opportunity to share God's Word with you today. This message is different and very important to all of us. One of the reasons this is so important, I think, to identify these different ways that God spoke to people in the Bible is that I've met people who God has been trying to speak to and they didn't realize it. And then they would come back to me in a couple of days and say, after we talked, God gave me a dream last night, or, you know, God spoke some other way. They mentioned, you know, things back to me like this, and they just hadn't, you know, been used to having a personal type of communication back and forth with the Lord, and it surprised them. I was in a restaurant about a month ago, and a young man come running up to me and said, you made me a miracle. Well, you know, he didn't say it quite right. I didn't make him a miracle and everything, but he was so happy and joyful and everything. And he said, after you spoke to me that night, and then he started telling me these things about what happened in his life, how God had revealed himself to him, and he was so excited. It never happened to him like that before. But Jesus says in John chapter 10, that my sheep hear my voice, from all others they'll flee. We need to learn to hear Jesus' voice. And again, one of the examples I think is about the clearest way to give you an idea of what this means is, like if you were your husband, your wife, or a friend went to a big birthday party on a big ballroom somewhere, and y'all got separated. Well, somebody could put a blindfold over you, and you could walk through the crowd of people with all them talking back and forth and, you know, singing and hollering life and like that. And with, even with a blindfold on, you could pick out your wife's voice and know when you met her that, you know, it was her talking to you, or your husband's voice or something like this. You could identify your husband, your wife's voice anywhere in that room without having to see them or anything. And that's the way it is with the Lord. with all the voices in our society coming at you from different angles and everything, and the devil's trying to do everything to confuse you and stuff, we've got to learn to communicate with the Lord to where we can walk through this society and hear him daily and recognize his voice speaking to us, you know, as a friend. And the more we study his word and everything, well, that will happen. And our relationship as we grow with him, it'll become easier to recognize his voice throughout the day. So that's what Jesus means when he says, my sheep will hear my voice and all others, they'll flee. The sheepfold will learn to hear the shepherd's voice. And that's what we must do. Now, and Jesus says also that we have to learn to hear God's voice and everything, because in John 6:45, Jesus says, we shall all be taught of God. And he says, every man, therefore, that heard and learned of the Father cometh unto me. So when God starts teaching us, you know, we're growing up from childhood and God starts teaching us things, naturally, he's going to lead us to Jesus, because he's going to start teaching us we're sinner. And then that Jesus is the answer for our sins, or what he did on the cross and his death, burial, and resurrection. You know, that the way was prepared for us. So we've got to learn to recognize God's voice. This example, like in Matthew 16:16, when Jesus asked the disciples, whom do you say that I am? And they said, well, some say you're a good man. Some say you're, you know, John the Baptist and another prophet or whatever. And then Jesus stopped and he said, who do you say that I am? And then Peter said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And then Jesus responds to him, says, blessed are thou, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood didn't reveal it to you, but my Father which is in heaven. So see, even, you know, Peter, it was revealed to him that Jesus was God's son by God in heaven, directly to Peter. And then that's when, in John 6:45, then, where Jesus said, they shall all be taught of God. See, we all have to have that personal revelation from God, because I can tell you about Jesus, I can tell you about God, but I can't prove him to you. The only way you can find out for sure, like I've told many people, is I don't know if you're familiar with the game 20 questions or not, you know, where people get around a room and somebody stands up and starts acting out somebody, and you have 20 questions you can ask, and he has to answer you honestly to try to guess who he's portraying. Well, that's what I tell him to do with God. I said, if you honestly want to know if God is real, start playing 20 questions with God. Pray and talk to him as if he is real, you know, and say, well, Lord, if you're real, you know, and give God an opportunity to reveal himself to you in a personal way. And he will. God will respond if you with an honest heart. And Jeremiah 29:13 says, you shall seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart. See, it's not just playing a game in this case. In this case, it's life or death for eternity. You know, you're seeking God and giving him an opportunity to reveal himself to you. Hebrews 11:6 says, it's impossible to please God without faith. And faith in Romans 10:17 says, faith comes by hearing, hearing the word of God. So that's why we need to learn to hear from God, see, because it's impossible to please him otherwise. He comes to us with his love in a lot of ways. But there's only one way we can respond positively to God, and that is through faith, by accepting and obeying his word. Not just hearing his word in our head. We can know a lot of scripture, which I did for 20-something years, and not have received it into your heart. You got to receive his word into your heart. Like Psalms 119:9 says, wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his way? It says, by taking heed thereto according to God's word. Now, when we take heed and receive his word into our heart, it comes alive in us. See, Jesus isn't, let's see, John 6:63, my words are spirit and they are life. So when we receive positively God's word into our heart, see, the spirit of those words, Christ, the living word then in us, is alive and starts working us. And that's what we call a work of grace. So the work of grace, or the spirit in our heart, is always a result of us making the choice to receive God's word, whatever he's spoken to us, into our heart. Well, like, if we don't receive his word into our heart, like the children of Israel, they all knew they were leaving the promise, leaving the captivity. of slavery and everything, going to the Promised Land. Well, when they got up to the Jordan River, 10 spies went over and looked at the land and everything. Well, 12 went over, but 10 of them came back and said, there's giants over there. Where's grasshoppers? We can't do that, you know. And they talked the children of Israel then into rejecting crossing over the Jordan because they didn't trust God enough that he'd take care of them. After all those miracles they'd seen coming to the Promised Land, all those miracles they'd seen getting out of slavery, in fact, you know, that God performed for the Pharaoh and everything, they didn't trust God enough that he'd take care of them when they moved across the Jordan and was fighting the giants or something. So that is called unbelief. When you know God's will, you hear his word, and then you reject it. In Hebrews chapter 3, verses 12 through 19, it says, they failed to enter into the promised land because of an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. See, when you depart from God's will, you're departing from him because he and his word are the same. You know, in the beginning was a word, and the word was God, and the word was God. See, so God doesn't just send his word to us. It's God himself coming to us to manifest in our minds a message that we recognize. And you know, in our language, we say, well, God sent me a message, or God spoke to me, or something like this. But no, it's not. It's God right there quickening in our mind a message. And when we reject it, that's unbelief. We're rejecting the living God, it says in Hebrews 3. Now, faith comes by hearing, but only if we accept and obey his word. But now, see, the important part of that is it's got to be his pure word. It can't be just something we make up, you know, and decide, hey, this is good. You know, this must be God. You know, we've got to know it's God, because Proverbs 35 and 6 says, every word of God is pure, a shield and put their trust in it. Add thou not to it, lest he reprove thee and thou be found a liar. And what that means is that if we claim something as God's word, or if God speaks to us and we add something to it, it becomes our word instead of his word. See, we're ambassadors. We're supposed to speak his word purely. That means we've got to have heard from him and know that it's God speaking to us to be able to confess it and respond to it by faith to his word. So faith is only based on God's pure word. Anything else, God will not back up if we add to it or take from it. And the problem with that is now in our society, we have 200 or 300 different denominational groups, well, denominations and other groups that are teaching so many different things that, you know, we hear all these voices from these different denominations and groups and everything. See, we've got to learn to hear God and know that it's him speaking to us. That's what Jesus said, my sheep hear my voice, my all others they'll flee, because you're going to hear a lot of different combinations. Like in one denomination, say it's speaking in tongues of the devil, and another denomination say it's the greatest thing that ever happened, and back and forth. The other denomination groups have some viewpoint in between those two extremes. But see, we've got to hear from God, because when we stand before him, he's going to ask us, how come we didn't come to him? Because, see, he wants to teach us. He wants to talk to us and share with us. And also, we have even 26 major versions of the copies of the Bible. You know, we've never seen and probably will never see the original texts that are over in Europe in the basement of some of those large churches and everything. But the copies that these smart people translate out, and they disagree with each other, and you know, so much so that we have 26 different major versions. We'll see which one is correct. One will say this, one will say that, you know, like that. See, and all of these things, we still are responsible for seeking God and learning to hear his voice and responding by faith. We're so blessed to have so many copies, because we can look at different of these smart people's interpretations of the original text and pray and seek the Lord. See, other people around the world don't have these. Some of them just one sheet of paper, one sheet of a scripture, a Bible or something, and they just treasure it so much just to have, you know, these copies. The early disciples didn't have, you know, the New Testament. You know, they were the ones that wrote the New Testament, you know, and God used them to share with us. So we're such a blessed generation, our society, have so many copies to read and study, concordances to study all these different subjects in the scripture and like this and everything. So we're really going to be held accountable. We're so blessed in all the generations like that. No other generation has had the capabilities that we have of researching God's word and seeking him. Now, but we got to have God's pure word. And we need to be seeking to learn to communicate back and forth. Learning these ways now, these eight ways that God spoke to people in the Bible, this will not guarantee that you'll get an answer from God. See, even just knowing all these different ways, you can see that he spoke to other people in this manner. Well, we must be seeking God with all our heart. It says in Deuteronomy 4:29 and also Jeremiah 29:13, you shall seek me and find me when you search with all your heart. See, so still, we've got to make a wholehearted, honest effort to open our hearts to the Lord, our minds and hearts to the Lord, for him to speak to us. Psalms 91:1 says, he that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide in the shadow of the Almighty. It's not secret because he hides it from us. It's secret because we need to seek the Lord and love him enough, care enough that we seek him for his word. 2 Chronicles 12:14, Rehoboam, Solomon's son, it said he did evil because he prepared not his heart to seek the Lord. It's evil for us not to. That's one of the evil things that's in people's lives today in our society, even Christians that are just, you know, going to church and, you know, going home, living a good life and, you know, paying their tithes and doing things like this, but yet not seeking that special holy calling. You know, in 2 Timothy 1:9, each one of us have such a special calling that God wants us to, you know, seek and find out about it. Says that he saved us, God saved us, and called us to a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which was given us in Christ Jesus before the world began. So if you're listening today and you have a low self-esteem, you don't feel like you're anywhere near fulfilled in life, and you know there's so much more you could do, that's that void in you that the Lord wants to fill. He wants to lead you into that holy calling of his. Because like in Psalms 16:11 says, thou wilt show me the path of life. In thy presence is fullness of joy. We can't have that joy in our heart of being fulfilled in life if we're not seeking God's holy calling for us. Now, we may never reach his perfect holy calling because, you know, we start so late in life and everything. But just to know in your heart that you're truly seeking it will bring such a peace in your heart from God, you know, filling that void in you. You can't get that anywhere else. I've seen actresses crying on television, you know, all the money you could imagine that you'd ever need like that, with, you know, a couple of beautiful children crying, saying, oh, there's nothing worth living for, you know, like this, because she didn't have God in her life. She didn't, you know, follow the Lord or seek him and his holy calling. And most people, they probably don't even realize that each of us have those special holy callings. If you want to be excited and you know, have joy in your heart, seek God's holy calling. Now, how do you seek? Just pray and study the scriptures and different things like this. And we're going to cover some more of those in just a minute, different ways that God spoke to people. Now, also, if you do not seek his holy calling, it's going to be waiting for you to judgment seat of Christ, because Romans 11:29 says the gifts and callings of God are without repentance. See, God doesn't change that holy calling for you just because you don't seek him. And also, the scripture doesn't say that there's a permissive will or anything, because he says that he has a special holy calling for us, created for us in Christ Jesus before the world began. Now, he won't just strike us down if we don't seek that and we don't achieve his holy calling or find his holy calling in our life and everything. But he doesn't make provisions for a permissive will. Now, he will still be trying to lead us into that holy calling regardless of what you choose to do. But the best thing to do would be seek as best you can. Now, to better understand these different ways that God speaks to people and everything, one of the first things we need to do is I'm going to briefly go the difference between a sign and a visible answer. I've covered this before in the 4th of January message, but in Matthew chapter 12, chapter 16, and Luke chapter 11, Jesus was speaking to the scribes and Pharisees, and they came to him and said, "Master, we would see a sign from thee." And Jesus answered and said, "An evil and adulterous generation seeketh after a sign. There will be no sign given it but the sign of prophet Jonas." Well, here God wasn't, Jesus wasn't talking bad about signs. He wasn't saying that the signs is what made them an evil generation. They were an evil generation before. Jesus' whole life was a sign to us. In just to give a quick example, in John chapter 11, verse 41, when Jesus was supposedly going to raise Lazarus from the dead, I say supposedly because you'll see here, Jesus didn't raise Lazarus from dead. Jesus prayed and his heavenly Father answered him and raised Lazarus from the dead. Now, in John 11, 41, Jesus is in front of a group of people now. He said, "Father, I thank thee that thou hast heard me, and I knew thou hearest me always, but because of the people which stand by, I said it, that they might believe that thou hast sent me." See, Jesus is going to pray now, and when he did, he prayed in front of the people out loud so they could hear his prayer, and then in verse 43, he says, "Lazarus, come forth." Now see, the Spirit of God then raised Lazarus from the dead, answering Jesus' prayer, just like he said he knew that his Father would answer his prayer. And when he came forth then, on down verse 45, it says, "Many of the Jews then, which came to Mary and had seen these things which Jesus did, believed on him." See, he gave them a sign that he was from God, that he was God's son, by praying out loud and then God answering him. See, so Jesus got a visible answer because Lazarus visibly came forth out of the grave. The people standing around him didn't pray. They heard his prayer and saw his answer. They got a sign. That's the difference between a sign and a visible answer. See, they all saw the same thing when Lazarus came out of the grave. But the people standing around didn't pray. They got a sign. So a sign is when you see something happen like that and you understand and know it's from God. In John chapter 20, verse 30, it says, "And many other signs truly did Jesus in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these were written that you might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you might have life through his name." See, Jesus' whole life was a sign to us. Now, also in John 21:25, at the end of the book of John, it says, "And there are also many other things which Jesus did, the which, if they should be written, every one, I suppose that even the world itself could not contain the books that should be written." Amen. See, so they're saying that Jesus did so many things that the world couldn't contain all of the books if they were written down. And just for an example, 16 times in the Bible, it in the New Testament, it makes a statement, "And they were all healed." And like Matthew 9:35, it says that Jesus went throughout all the villages and all the cities. That's all means all of them, you know, all the villages, all the cities, preaching the gospel and healing all manner of sicknesses and diseases. Can you imagine now how many people got healed like that? And if each one of them was, you know, sick and everything, you could write a book about each one of them just about. And it says 16 times. Now, two of these, 14 of them was Jesus, and a couple of them was probably repeated from, you know, different books talking about the same circumstances. But it even says one time that Peter, that all were healed. They even pulled people to his shadow. He was so filled with the Spirit of God and the Holy Spirit. You know, he was so filled that it just people laying in his shadow would be healed. And then when the Apostle Paul was shipwrecked on that island, it says they were all healed. God worked through him to heal all the people on that island. See, and if you start writing books about each one of those people's lives and how they got healed and everything like that, Jesus provided a lot of signs for us. And well, John 3:16-17 says, "For God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth him shall not perish but have eternal life. For God sent not his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. See, he was using his son Jesus as an example for us. Signs. So signs aren't bad. Signs is not what made the scribes and Pharisees an evil and adulterous generation of people. They were that way. They just wanted, you know, Jesus to do something so they could criticize him more. And he said, an evil and adulterous generation seeketh after a sign. Well, God's going to give us signs a lot of times to get our attention. We may be going the wrong way, and then God will do something to get our attention. Pray about it when things like that happen. So it's time to take a break now. So we'll take a break and be right back in a couple of minutes, and we'll start going through the rest of these examples of how God spoke to people.
We'll be right back with more of God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard Hardin right here on K98 Talk. God's now be heard on Monday, Wednesday, and Friday mornings at 7 a.m. Central, 8 Eastern, and on Sunday mornings at his regular time, 6 Central, 7 Eastern. Join with him and let's turn our country back to God. It only takes a spark to start a forest fire. Let's get on fire for the Lord. Right here on K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network. Visit Richard's website at rahardin.com. That's the World Wide Web at rahardin.com. At his website, you can see a summary of the 6 books he has written, where purchases may be made. He also has a link to 18 videos on YouTube and several blogs about Christian beliefs. If you prefer, visit amazon.com/Kindle and type in Richard Hardin to see and purchase his books. The staff of K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network is proud to announce that our very own Rowdy Rick Robinson has been selected as one of the top conservative talk show hosts in the nation for his program, America Off the Rails. Again, congratulations to Rowdy Rick Robinson for a job well done and another reason to stay connected to K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network. Now back to God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard Hardin.
Welcome back to our program this morning, the 8 ways that God spoke to people in the scriptures. Last week I covered the first 5 ways, or the last message that is, and the 4th of January I covered the 5 ways. Today we're going to pick up and review those real quick and then get to the ways 6, 7, and 8. But naturally the first way that God wants to speak to people is through his scripture. In fact, in Isaiah 34:16, God said, "Seek ye out of the book of the Lord and read," you know, encouraging us to. And then 2 Timothy, "All scripture is the inspiration of God and profitable for doctrine, reproof, correction, for instruction in righteousness." Now, Jesus thought the Old Testament was worthy enough to quote that when, you know, he was in the wilderness in Matthew chapter 4 in verses 4, 7, and 10, he quoted Deuteronomy when the devil tempted him. He said, "It is written, it is written, it is written." And then that's Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 3, and Deuteronomy 6, 16, and Deuteronomy chapter 10, verse 12. If it's good enough for Jesus to quote, you know, the Old Testament scriptures to fight the devil, it certainly should be good enough for us. But that's one of the ways God wants to speak to us, by studying his word and, you know, him speaking to us through his word. The second way is through the Holy Spirit. Now, this way joins with us reading and studying God's word, because throughout the daytime, if we have God's word in our heart, we've studied it and we know his word, then see, the Holy Spirit then, when something happens throughout the daytime, can bring to remembrance the word that we have in our heart. or a mind like this. And that's why, you know, each of us start with a pure heart at salvation. In Ezekiel 36:26, God said, a new heart also will give you, a new spirit will I put within you. I'll take away the stony heart out of your flesh, give you heart of flesh, and I'll put my spirit in you. Now see, his spirit, the living word, will grow in the word in us as we study and allow him to put more of his word in us as we grow closer to him and, you know, our walk with him. But now, he didn't change our minds though. In Apostle Paul had a lot to remember. He had persecuted and killed Christians thinking he was actually doing God's will. See, he had a lot of bad memories from the past and everything. And he taught a lot about mind control, like in Philippians 4:6, be anxious for nothing. See, as soon as something starts bothering you, he says, be anxious for nothing, but in all things with prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be known to God. So he's saying, you know, just when something happens, turn to God, you know, immediately. Don't wait till it's so bad and then turn. Now you can, but, you know, he encourages right at the beginning. But in Romans chapter 12, verse 2, he says, be not conformed to this world, be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove that is a good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Now see, you do that by studying God's word. And then throughout the daytime, then he'll bring the Holy Spirit will bring to remembrance those words that you've been studying, you know, in the scripture, and come alive to you and give you direction and guidance throughout the daytime. 2 Corinthians 10 says, for we walk not in the flesh, but well, we not walk. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. Now, how do we know something exalts itself against the knowledge of God? Because we've been studying his written word, you know, and we have that in our minds and hearts. And then when things happen throughout the daytime, whoops, we hear something, say, that doesn't go according to the scripture. And then it says, bringing into captivity every thought to obedience of Christ. So when we hear things throughout the daytime that don't go according to God's word, you know, and the Holy Spirit reminds us of that and brings it up to us, then we submit that then to the captivity of Christ, the living word in us, and we don't obey that then. We don't listen to that voice. We hear his voice and follow him. So God speaks to us through studying his written word. The Holy Spirit then uses the written word in us to guide us throughout the daytime. And also the third way then, God speaks through preachers, prophets, teachers, and other Christian brothers and sisters like this. You know, we're sharing with each other testimonies and of what God has done in our lives and things that God has taught us so that other people can get an idea, you know, like this. And in 1 Corinthians 12:7, it says, but the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit withal. You know, teachers and prophets, God, you know, gives them inspiration. But it's not just for them to have inspiration. It's for them to share with us and for us to share back and forth with each other. And it's for all of us to profit. And like in Hebrews 2:4, God also bearing them witness, both with signs and wonders, divers miracles and gifts of the Holy Ghost, according to his own will. See, he's going to be working through us to be a blessing to others, working through you to be a blessing to me. And that's how we're joined together in the body of Christ then, sharing what God has blessed each of us with so that we can all grow closer to the Lord and grow in unity of the faith. And let's see, Ephesians 4:4, it says, we got one God, one spirit, one faith. We shouldn't have 200 or 300 different denominations and everything. They should be one group of Christians that are born with the Spirit of God in their heart, you know, Christ in us. And it should be just one group in unity of the faith. And that's what we should be seeking and everything. So God speaks to us through his living, through his word as we study it. He speaks to the Holy Spirit throughout the daytime to bring to remembrance, you know, those things that we've got in our heart, God's word, and then our brothers and sisters in Christ and everything, and preachers and teachers, they share with us, you know, God's word through them to us. So that's, you know, and now God also comes directly to us in dreams, the fourth way. There's so many dreams. Well, like in, we just went through the Christmas season, celebrating Jesus' birth, but in Matthew, the first two chapters, there's five dreams. When the wise men went to Herod and said they're looking for a king that was being born, he told them, you know, well, come back and tell me when you find him. You know, I want to go worship him too. Well, God warned the wise men in a dream in Matthew chapter 1, don't go back to Herod. Flee from him. You know, go back a different way. And then in chapter 1 also, God gave Joseph a dream that Mary really was pregnant, conceived of, you know, by the Holy Spirit. You know, Joseph was really struggling with that. You know, how did Mary get pregnant and everything? You know, well, God gave him a dream and told him, you know, to take Mary. It says, Joseph, thou son of David, fear not to take unto thee Mary thy wife, for that which is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost. That was in a dream. Now, when Herod started looking for the, you know, the newborn king that the wise men told him about and started killing the children, in Matthew chapter 2, verse 13, God gave Joseph a dream and said, take the mother and the child and flee to Egypt. And then 8 years later, when Herod died, God gave Joseph a dream and said, leave Egypt, go back to Israel. And then when he got to Israel, God gave him a dream and told him where to go live. And so God used dreams to, you know, give them direction and everything. And he'll use dreams today too. The Bible is a dream book from cover to cover. The book of Revelations is a dream. Joseph and Jacob's, you know, youngest son, Joseph, that got sold into Egypt and everything. God used five dreams in his life to take him out of Canaan, the land of Canaan, and make him the second highest ruler of Egypt. Only the Pharaoh was above Joseph. And God used five dreams in his case. Read those studies from about Genesis, about chapter 30 to 50, something like that, and see how God directed Joseph's life. And also, supposedly Pilate's wife was a Christian. Many think that she was. But when Jesus stood before Pilate in Matthew 27, 19, God sent Pilate what I call a love message, because he loved Pilate, and he loves everybody with a perfect love. And it's not his will that the wicked perish, but they turn from their ways. It says in Ezekiel 33:11. So Pilate's wife sent to him and said, leave that just man alone, because what I suffer today of him in a dream. See, God gave his wife a dream. She then relayed that message that God gave her in a dream to Pilate. Now, and in Acts chapter 2, verse 17, it says that old men are going to dream dreams, it says here. And it shall come to pass in the last day, saith God, I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, which is next in my list, and your old men shall dream dreams. So I guess I'll keep dreaming dreams. Well, okay. The fifth way is through visions, which was just mentioned there. But in Genesis 15:1, God gave Abram a vision to separate him out of his homeland and be the father of, you know, many nations and many peoples. Let's see. After these days, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision, saying, fear not, Abram, I am thy shield and thy exceeding great reward. God gave Eli and Samuel dreams in 1 Samuel chapter 3, verses 11 to 15. The book of Obadiah is a vision. Let's see, the book of Nahum is a vision. And there were visions in the book of Daniel, of Nebuchadnezzar's dream, things like this. So God spoke to people. Vision, the difference between a vision and a dream, I guess, is about that, like a dream would be at nighttime where you go to sleep and you actually have a dream. But a vision, you could just be walking down the street and all of a sudden God gave you a vision. I was driving down the street one time and God gave me a vision, and it led me to some people he wanted me to witness to. You just have to, you know, be open to receiving things like that, and the Lord will speak to you. In the book of Habakkuk, there's visions. But then one of the important ones in the New Testament, when Jesus struck Saul down, who became Apostle Paul, you know, and on the road to Damascus as he was going to, you know, arrest and Christians and persecute them and everything. And he says, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? And then Saul said, who are you, Lord? And he said, I am Jesus whom thou persecutest. Well, right there immediately then, Paul was open-minded and everything and teachable spirit. He changed. And from then on, he started teaching and preaching Christ Jesus, that he had been crucifying the Christians before and, persecuting them in all different kind of ways, throwing them in jail and things. But now he turned right around. He became a Christian, and but he was blinded on the road to Damascus, and they had to lead him then to Damascus. And here in Acts chapter 9, verse 10, there was a certain disciple at Damascus named Ananias. And to him, the Lord said in a vision, Ananias, and he said, behold, I'm here, Lord. Now, the vision was that God spoke to him and said, go pray for this Saul. And Ananias was kind of afraid to. He said, Lord, he's been killing Christians and everything. He said, but he's my chosen vessel now. Go pray for him. And his eyes will be open. He'll see again. And that was his way of introducing Paul then, his name was changed from Saul to Paul, into the Christian community. Then God gave Peter three visions in Acts chapter 10 to send him over to talk to a Gentile, Cornelius, because Cornelius was a very good man, his neighbors all liked him, his family and everything. But the Lord told him to go call Peter, Simon Peter, and he'll tell you what you need to do. So it said that Cornelius prayed always and, gave alms and did everything like that. Such a good person, but he was missing Jesus. And so God gave Peter those visions, three visions, to have him go talk to that Gentile, which the Jews didn't do in those days, but he did now because he obeyed the Lord and went and told Cornelius. And then Cornelius then accepted and received Jesus in his heart, his Christ, the Spirit of Christ in his heart, and became a Christian. So Paul's protection in Acts chapter 18, verses 9 through 10, says, then spake the Lord to Paul in a night vision. I don't know the difference between a night vision, day vision, except it was just nighttime, I guess, when he had that vision. Instead of a dream, he had a vision. He wasn't asleep or something. Be not afraid, but speak, and hold not thy peace. For I am with thee, and no man shall set on thee to hurt thee. For I have much people in this city. He's telling him, you go ahead and preach and teach, said, because I've got plenty of people here to, help protect you and everything. So visions and dreams are two ways that God, spoke to people then, and he certainly can still do it today. Pray about them, make sure, what you're doing is received from the Lord and everything. Now, angels. There were angels in those days. There's angels in our days. I haven't personally spoken to an angel that I know of, but we'll see later. Could have. All of us could have in some way or another. Because like one of the last things, one of the warnings in Hebrews 13:2 is, be not forgetful to entertain strangers, for thereby some have entertained angels unaware. So when you go out to a mall or go to a shopping center today or tomorrow or something like that, you think everybody's going to just leave, go out and get in their car and go home. Some of them that you meet might be angels, and they don't just get in their car and go home. They may go back to be with the Lord. So you never can tell when you might meet something like an angel or something. Man, my buddy was flying about 15 years ago from Washington, D.C. to St. Louis, TWA's hub, the airline hub, TWA at that time. And then from from St. Louis here to Oklahoma City. Well, I went to sleep. I didn't know what happened and everything, but my buddy, he's sitting in the back seat of the back row. And he was afraid of heights, so he had always sat on the aisle seat. During that flight, God sent an angel to him. Now, a lot of times when God sends angel people, the angels appear to be like somebody that you have known in the past, so you won't be so afraid. And a friend of his that had died about 4 years before, a lady friend, She came and sat down on a seat by him, he said, and told her, "Don't be afraid, but look out the window." Well, when he looked out the window, he saw the fuel pouring out of the wing tank, and he called the stewardess in, and she at first said, "Well, that's just condensation." He said, "You look at that. That's not condensation. Go get the pilot, or I'm going to go get him." So she went up and got the pilot and came back, and boy, that pilot ran up there and shut the wing tank down. And when I woke up, I was, in the middle of the plane over the wing, because that's the smoothest ride, setting over the wing sections. Well, we just flew straight in over the arch there in St. Louis and just set down so quick. And normally during that time, TWA had so many flights coming and going that you'd have to wait 30, 45 minutes. And sometimes even an hour, there'd be so many. And I could see planes all around us, but yet we went straight in and sat down. And he told me later then why. Now see, God sent an angel to protect us. I didn't see the angel, something like that, but it really gave me confidence, really gave me, a joy to know that God did that and let my friend, who wasn't a Christian at the time, actually talk with the angel, or the angel talked to him. And I was able to pray with him for salvation about 6 months before he died. It wasn't right then, but it was, a couple of years later after that, that he did that. But anyway, God spoke to Mary through the angel Gabriel. It was sent from God to Mary and said, "Hail, thou art highly favored." Now, highly favored goes with mercy. She was not filled with grace. Highly favored is a Old Testament relationship with the Lord, to where God would bless the people that were seeking to serve him and everything. And like it says in Psalms 25:10, it said, "Mercy and truth are all the ways of the Lord to those who obey his covenants and testimonies." In the Old Testament, the people had mercy and truth, and also says that in Isaiah 59 also. I'll get that in a minute. But anyway, mercy and truth. They had God's love to them and his spirit, his love on them, but not in their hearts. Now, it says, "Thou art highly favored, the Lord's with thee. Blessed art thou among women. Fear not, Mary, for thou hast found favor with God. Thou shalt conceive in thy womb and bring forth a son. Thou shalt call his name Jesus." So see, God sent an angel to speak his words to her. Now see, those living words that angel spoke to Mary are the living words that she received into her heart, that was the seed of God that was used to conceive Jesus in her womb. See, the living word of God coming into Mary, she received into her heart. Now, the disciples in Acts chapter 5 says, "But the angel of the Lord by night opened the prison doors and brought them forth and said, Go stand and speak in the temple to the people all the words of this life." The disciples have been told not to teach and preach in the name of Jesus. They've been doing so many great things that Sanhedrin, didn't know what to do with them. And they, called them before them and said, "Don't do it anymore." Well, they said that one thing that they did, though, in Acts chapter 4, verse 13, it says they recognized they were ignorant and unlearned people, but that they had been with Jesus. So see, they were doing the same type of miracles and everything that Jesus did when he was here. And they didn't know how to handle it anyway. In Acts chapter 8, verse 26, the angel of the Lord spake unto Philip, one of the disciples, saying, "Arise and go toward the south in the way that goeth down from Jerusalem to Gaza, which is in the desert." Well, when Philip did what the angel told him to do, he saw this Ethiopian who was traveling in a chariot and everything, and he ran up to get beside the chariot and saw that the Ethiopian ruler was reading in the book of Isaiah. And he's asking him a question, something about, "Do you understand what you're reading like yet?" And the Ethiopian invited him to get up in the chariot with him, explain it to him. Well, he received Christ, and then they saw some water down there. He said, "Well, what would stop me from being baptized?" He said, "Nothing." They stopped the chariot, and he got baptized there. And then Philip just seemed to kind of disappear in the spirit some way or another, it says. It indicates that he just kind of disappeared and was gone. But the angel had told him to go down south there, and that's when he met the Ethiopian. Cornelius, which I mentioned earlier in Acts chapter 10, he saw in a vision, evidently about the ninth hour of the day, an angel of God coming in him. See, here he had a combination of a vision and the angel, and saying to him, Cornelius. Cornelius was afraid, and he said, "What is it, Lord?" And the angel said unto him, "Thy prayers and thy alms are coming up for a memorial before God. Now send men to Joppa and call for one Simon, whose surname is Peter, and he shall tell thee what thou ought to do." And that then is when Peter came and told him, and he got saved and received Christ in his heart, him and his family. Peter was in prison one time. They had killed James, and Herod had, and the Romans and the Sanhedrin, all of them, kind of liked it and everything. So he was planning on killing Peter too. Acts chapter 12, verse 7, "And behold, the angel of the Lord came upon him, and the light shined in the prison, and he smote Peter on the side." He hit him on the side to wake him up, and raised him up, saying, "Arise up quickly," and his chains fell off from his hands. And as they were going out, even the gate opened by itself, and then Peter realized, hey, this is an angel that's done this. And then the angel disappeared. Angels wasn't always bringing good news. Herod, in Acts chapter 12, verses 22 to 23, it says he was telling people how great he was and how he had done so much for the land there and everything. And the people gave a shout, saying, "This is the voice of God, not of man." And immediately the angel of the Lord smote him, Herod, because he gave not God the glory, and he was eaten of worms and gave up the ghost. Now, the last one before we take a break is Paul was headed to Rome, and he was in a storm, real bad storm, in Acts 27:23, and there stood an angel of the night, an angel of God. He said, he told them that there stood by me in the night an angel of God whose I am and I serve, saying, "Fear not, Paul, thou must be brought before Caesar, and God hath given thee all the people that sail with thee." So he told them, Paul told them, God's going to protect all of you, and we're going to get to Rome because God is sending me to Rome. And an angel told him that night to let him know that he was going there. It's time for the next break now. So I'll be back in a couple of minutes, and we'll start on the last two ways.
We'll be right back with more of God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard Hardin right here on K98 Talk. Visit Richard's website at rahardin.com. That's the World Wide Web at rahardin.com. At his website, you can see a summary of the 6 books he has written, where purchases may be made. He also has a link to 18 videos on YouTube and several blogs about Christian beliefs. If you prefer, visit amazon.com/Kindle and type in Richard Hardin to see and purchase his books. K98 Talk is expanding its lineup for 2015. This means we are expanding our advertising base. Whether you're a startup trying to push through to the next level or an established business trying to supplement your advertising budget, web-based advertising is a solid investment. Thanks to Talk's newest partnership with TuneIn Radio and instant access to our sister station, K98 FM, we give you worldwide access at a reasonable cost. Interested parties should email us at advertise@k98talk.org. K98talk.com, a leader in internet radio. So grab your seatbelts and take the ride of your life on K98talk.com. The staff of K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network is proud to announce that our very own Rowdy Rick Robinson has been selected as one of the top conservative talk show hosts in the nation for his program, America Off the Rails. Again, congratulations to Rowdy Rick Robinson for a job well done and another reason to stay connected to K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network.
For past programs of God's Pure Word of Faith, go to www.spreaker.com. That's Spreaker, Spreaker.com. In the search box at the top of the page, enter my name, Richard Hardin, H-A-R-D-I-N, and click on it. A picture with a cross and God's Pure Word of Faith, Richard Hardin, will show up. Click on the picture of the cross. A listing of all the past programs will then show up.
You're listening to God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard Hardin. Richard will guide you through the Bible and help you find God's purpose for your life. Now here's teacher and author Richard Hardin.
Welcome back. We've been covering the eight ways that God spoke to people in the Scriptures. So far we've covered, you know, like God's written word, how he speaks to us, and his Holy Spirit, that he brings his word back to remembrance throughout the daytime that we have in our heart. That means we need to be studying his word and putting it in our hearts and minds. He speaks through people, preachers, prophets, teachers, and other Christian brothers and sisters to us. That's the third way. And he spoke and to a lot of people in the Bible in dreams, to Joseph, and well, you know, when Solomon and God were talking and God asked him, what would he like? He said, you know, wisdom to rule the people. That was in a dream in 1 Kings chapter 3. And also in 1 Kings chapter 9, God and Solomon were talking back and forth in dreams. And so God used visions many times throughout the Scripture to just day visions where he would just put things, pictures like in people's minds and messages in their mind. Called visions. Then he sent angels. In fact, one of the good scriptures that we have about angels is in, let's see, Psalm 34:7 says, the angel of the Lord encamps around about them that fear him and delivers them. So, you know, as we're seeking to serve the Lord, we have his angel going with us. Anyway, now the last two ways, audible voice of God, and then some ways that are different that I call educational prayers. But anyway, audible voice of God. God spoke to a lot of people in the Scriptures. In fact, I've had him speak to me at least once in a audible voice. I was years ago, I'd get up and read and, you know, have prayer and everything before I'd go to work. Well, one morning I was kind of sleepy and I was on the couch reading and I went to sleep. And Lord woke me up so that I wouldn't be late to work. And he called my name. And that was the most beautiful sound that I think I've ever heard. Now, Richard doesn't sound that beautiful just saying the word Richard. But it was like thousands of stringed instruments, each playing its part. And it was like, Richard. Something like that. It was so beautiful the way God put all that together and everything like that. It just, anyway, but he woke me up and I got to work on time. That's the only time I know of that he has spoken to me like that audibly. But anyway, in Exodus chapter 3, you know, you've heard the burning bush story about Moses. He was up in the mountain and he was walking down his path and all of a sudden he looked over and there was a bush burning. But the bush wasn't burning up. It was just burning. So he stopped out of curiosity, naturally, you know, like it, and turned aside to go over. And then God spoke to him audibly. That's in Exodus chapter 3, if you want to read that, what he said and like this. But he told Moses he's going to use him to, you know, deliver the children of Israel out of the slavery in Egypt and send him along with Aaron. Anyway, again, in Exodus 19, God spoke to Moses. It says, and when the voice of the trumpet sounded long, waxed louder and louder, Moses spake, and God answered him by a voice. Okay. Now, in the book of Samuel, chapter 3, verses 4 through 11, God spoke three times to the young boy Samuel and called him by name. And each time the young boy didn't recognize being God, so he jumped up and ran to Eli the priest. You know, Samuel was serving in the temple. And he ran to Eli and woke him up and said, here am I, you know, you call me? And Eli each time said, no, I didn't call you. Go back and go to bed. Lay down again. Well, then finally Eli decided, hey, that must be God speaking to him. So he told Samuel, said, if he calls you again, say, go lay down, and it shall be if he call thee, thou say, speak, Lord, thy servant heareth. So Samuel went and laid down, and God came and spoke to him again. And then he gave him a message about Eli. Eli had some wicked sons that were working in the temple, and they had prostitution going on. They were selling things to make money and everything to give people sacrifice things. And so Eli was warned, and he didn't take care of that. But anyway, God removed him and his sons from that, and Eli became the judge or the priest during that time period in 1 Samuel. Now, also David, 2 Chronicles 6, verse 4, Solomon said, blessed be the Lord God of Israel, who hath with his hands fulfilled that which he spake with his mouth to my father David, saying. See, so it's indicated here that God actually spoke to David audibly there. And then when Paul, as I mentioned earlier, you know, the story about on the road to Damascus, when Saul at that time was his name, but was going to with a permission from the scribes and Pharisees, he had a letter in his hand giving him permission to persecute Christians. Well, he was struck down on the road, and then Jesus spoke to him audibly and said, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? And he said, who art thou, Lord? And the Lord said, I am Jesus whom thou persecutest. Now listen to this next. It's hard for thee to kick against the pricks. Now see, there wasn't a just specific time that Paul was going to have to be saved or something. You know, in fact, the scripture says now is the time of salvation. Right now around the world is the time for people to get saved. But what this is saying about the Apostle Paul, God didn't just wait for that particular moment on the road to Damascus, you know, for Jesus to speak to him and strike him down and everything. It says, it's hard for thee to kick against the pricks. That's why if you have some two mules pulling a wagon or pulling a plow or something like that, and one of them kind of lays back and, you know, lets the other one do the work. Well, they'd have this, you know, stick with a nail in it at the end of it or something like that. So, you know, they could reach up and, you know, stick it in their hind end, you know, and get them to, you know, get on up there and start, you know, carrying an equal load, you know, pulling their share. But then a lot of times, you know, the mules or whatever didn't like it, and they'd kick back there, you know, and resist it. They didn't want to. Well, that's what he's talking about here. See, so this indicates that God had been, or Jesus had been speaking to Paul before, trying to get his attention and everything, but Paul had been resisting that. He had been kind of kicking against the pricks, it says here. That is, but then this time, Jesus stopped him, and okay, this is it, and told him, you know, it's time for you to change or do something. And Paul, trembling and astonished, said, Lord, what wilt thou have me do? See, the first thing he said, what I do? And the Lord said to him, arise, go to the city, and it should be told thee what to do. And that's when he gave a vision into Ananias to go pray for him, and his eyes would be opened again. So these are seven of the ways that God spoke to people in the Bible. Again, God's written word, the Holy Spirit reminding us throughout the day and bringing to memory God's written word to give us guidance, and so we can submit things to the obedience of Christ. Preachers and teachers and Christian brothers and sisters that we meet during the daytime, God speaks through people. There's three ways. And then dreams, night dreams, visions. God sends angels sometimes. He speaks in audible voices. Now, some of you may recognize some of those ways, like dreams or visions or something like this. Pray and make sure that it's from the Lord if you don't understand it. Now, some dreams I've had, you know, you don't have to. It's just clear. God speaks and you know it's God. Now, those are much more comfortable to deal with than some where you might have a question. But anytime you have a question like this, take it to the Lord in prayer. Don't just run off assuming something if you have any doubt, because God doesn't want you to go off in doubt doing things, because you can't be going by faith in it, because faith comes by hearing by the word of God. And if you've heard from God's word, see, you'll be out of doubt. So if you got doubt, take it to the Lord in prayer. Now, There's an eighth way, which is very interesting, that I think many of you might like here. If in all these ways you do not know God's will, and you're seeking God's will, and sometimes it seems like God kind of holds back and wants to see how much we love him, how much we'll take the time to seek him. Do we really care, you know, enough, love him enough to seek him for his will? Well, these are what I call educational or instructional prayers. Now, let me read you a story, and that's what these are. These are going to be stories here. The first one's going to be in Genesis chapter 24. You know, God called Abraham out and said he's going to be the father of many nations, and, you know, he's going to be, you know, huge, you know, following throughout the years and everything like this. But to do that, he would have to have a son, and the son would have to, you know, have some children, you know, for this the will of God to grow and develop. Well, Abraham had a son, Isaac, but he didn't have a wife. And he was getting kind of old, so Abraham decided he was going to have to do something about this. So he sent his servant in back over to his homeland to get a wife for his son, Isaac, from his people that he had, you know, been separated from in Syria. He had been separated from, but he wanted Isaac to have a wife from his family line. Now, so this is how the servant then, you know, it was interesting because Isaac didn't go with the servant. excuse me, Abraham sent his servant. And this starts in Genesis 24. Abraham then, verse 4, called the servant in and said, "But thou shalt go into my country, to my kindred, and take a wife unto my son Isaac." And the servant said unto him, "Peradventure the woman will not be willing to follow me into this land. Must I needs bring thy son again into the land from whence thou camest?" Now, it's interesting here, but Abraham said unto him, "Beware thou that thou bring my son thither again." See, he's saying, no, you won't take my son to the land. He said, "But the Lord God of heaven, which took me from my father's house, and from the land of my kindred, and which spake unto me, and that sware unto me, saying, unto thy seed will I give this land, he shall send his angel before thee." You know, Abraham's promising this servant that the angel of God's going with him to help him. And said, "And thou shalt take a wife unto my son from thence. And if the woman will not be willing to follow thee, then thou shalt be clear from this, my oath, only bring not my son thither again." Now, why he said that and everything, it never explains, but he didn't want his son to go. He wanted the servant to do it all. In verse 9, the servant put his hand under the thigh of Abraham, his master, and swore to him concerning that matter. That was some form of making oaths in those days. Verse 10, and the servant took 10 camels. Now remember, 10 camels of his master and departed. And all the goods of his master were in his hand, and he arose and went to Mesopotamia and to the city of Nahor. Now, it doesn't say what was on those camels, but you'll find out later that he had a lot of wealth with him, jewels and, you know, all this kind of precious stones and everything. He went to Nahor, the city of Nahor, and he made his camels to kneel down without the city by a well of water at the time of the evening, when the time that women would go out to draw water. So he goes back over to Abraham's homeland, Nahor, and he gets by the well of water because he knows all the eligible young women are going to be coming to the well to draw water in the evening when it's cool. Now listen to what he does in verse 12. This is his prayer now. This is why I call it educational prayer, because he prays in a way that when God answers his prayer, that he'll know exactly which woman is God's will to take back to be Isaac's wife. See, he didn't want to try to guess or something like this. He wanted to know exactly the one God wanted for Isaac. So he wasn't testing God or anything, but listen to his prayer. Servant said, "O Lord God of my master Abraham, I pray thee, send me good speed this day and show kindness to my master Abraham. Behold, I stand here by the well of water." Now, God knew he was standing there by the well of water, but anyway, that's part of his prayer. Behold, I stand here by the well of the water, and the daughters of the men of the city come out to draw water. Let it come to pass that the damsel, the young lady, to whom I say, let down thy pitcher, I pray thee, that I may drink, and she shall say, drink, and I will give thy camels drink also. Now remember now, he's got 10 camels. That's going to be a lot of watering for 10 thirsty camels. And she'll say, drink, and I will give thy camels drink also. Let the same be she that thou hast appointed for thy servant Isaac, and thereby shall I know that thou hast shown kindness to my master. He's saying, you know, he's not testing God or anything like that. He's just saying, I want to know your will. I want to know exactly the woman that you want me to take back to be Isaac's wife. See? And so he says, I'm going to ask him for a drink of water, and the one you want me to take back will not only say, I'll give you a drink of water. Now, to see this young lady that answers this, she's going to have to go up and down that well, bringing water to those 10 thirsty camels. It's not going to be just something that any woman would lightly say, sure, I'll give you a drink of water and I'll water your 10 thirsty camels too. See, that's not going to come out very easy. And it didn't come out of Rebecca very easy, you'll notice, but anyway, later. Now, and it came to pass before he had done speaking that behold, Rebekah came out, who was born of Bethuel, son of Milcah, the wife of Nahor, Abraham's brother, with her pitcher upon her shoulder. And the damsel, the young lady, was very fair to look upon, a virgin, neither had any man known her. And she went down to the well, filled her pitcher, and came up. Now the servant ran to meet her and said, let me, I pray thee, drink a little water of thy pitcher. Now listen to how she answers, kind of hesitant here. Later, she said, drink, my lord. And she hasted and let down her pitcher upon her hand and gave him drink. See, she didn't answer the whole thing yet. But when she had done giving him drink, she said, I will draw water for thy camels also until they have done drinking. Now, he didn't jump up and down, you know, with that as being his answer yet, because she said, until they have done drinking. So she hasted and emptied her pitcher into the trough, ran again into the well to draw water, and drew for all the camels. Now, she went up and down and up and down that well for 10 thirsty camels, and he just sat there and watched her. Okay, and the man wondering, the servant wondering, held his peace, to wit, whether the Lord had made his journey prosperous or not. See, he waited till she watered those camels like she said she's going to. And it came to pass, as the camels had done drinking, that the man took a golden earring out of and a half a shekel of weight and two bracelets for her hands of 10 shekels weight of gold. And he said, whose daughter art thou? Tell me, I pray thee, is there room in thy father's house for us to lodge in? She said to him, I am the daughter of Bethuel, the son of Milcah, which she bare unto Nahor. Now that was Abraham's brother, remember, Nahor. She said, moreover, unto him, we have both straw and provender, which was food and stuff like this, enough and room to lodge in. Then see, the servant bows his head and thanks the Lord. The servant bowed his head and worshiped the Lord and said, blessed be the Lord God of my master Abraham, who has not left destitute my master of his mercy and his truth. I being in the way, he said, just me, a simple little old person here, you know, I being in the way, the Lord has led me to the house of my master's brethren, you know, across the desert, straight to the house of where you're supposed to go. It amazed him. He said, you know, just I being in the way, you still did it. Now, verse 28, and the damsel ran, Rebekah ran, and told them of her mother's house, these things. And Rebekah had a brother, and his name was Laban. And Laban ran out unto the man and unto the well. And it came to pass, when he saw the earrings, bracelets on his sister's hands, and when he heard the words of Rebekah, his sister, saying, thus spake this man unto me, and he came in unto the man, and behold, he stood by the camels at the well. And he said, come in, thou blessed of the Lord. This is, Laban, her brother, telling the servant that. He says, wherefore standest thou without? For I have prepared the house and the room for the camels. Now, and the servant came into the house, and he ungirded his camels and gave straw and provender for the camels, water to wash his feet. And the men and the men's feet that were with him. See, so the servant wasn't by himself. There were some other servants with him. And there was set meat before him to eat. That is, they gave the servant, set out a, you know, a table of food and everything, meat. But listen to what the servant says. And he said, I will not eat until I have told my errand. And then so Laban said, speak on. See, the servant was so concerned about finding God's will, he watered his camels and he fed them and everything. But he would not eat himself. He wanted to get to the point. The first thing he did when he got to town was pray so God could tell him which woman to take that he wanted to take back to be Isaac's wife. Now, he doesn't want to sit down and eat himself until he tells them and finds, you know, what they're going to do. So the servant says, I am Abraham's servant, and the Lord has blessed my master greatly. And he goes on through this then, telling Laban and the father and the people of the household, you know, about how rich Abraham is and everything, and how, you know, they have a son, Isaac, that needs a wife and everything. And it goes on down through the next few verses like that. And let's see. Through verse 41, 42, verse 42 said, I came to this day unto the well and said, now he tells them here about his prayer. When he got to the well of water, I prayed, O Lord of my master Abraham, if thou do prosper my way, I stand by the well of water, and it shall come to pass when the virgin cometh forth to draw water, and I say to her, give me, I pray thee, a little water of thy pitcher to drink. And she shall say, both drink thou, and I will draw water for the camels. Let the same be the woman that thou, the Lord has appointed for my master's son. And he said, before I had finished, you know, speaking, behold, Rebekah came, and she went down to the well and drew water. And I said to her, give me a drink. And she made haste and let down her pitcher, and she gave me a drink. And she said, drink, and I will give thy camels drink also. So I drank, and she made my camels drink. See, the servant is repeating all this prayer and everything, what happened, back to Laban and the father Bethuel, because the men had, you know, control of families in those days. And he said, and I asked her, whose daughter art thou? And the daughter of Bethuel, Nahor's son. And she identified herself. And I bowed down and worshiped the Lord and blessed the God of my father, you know, of my master Abraham, which had led me the right way to take the master's brother's daughter unto his son. Now listen to these next three verses. And now, see, the servant's done everything he can. He's identified, God's identified to him that Rebekah is the one. He goes to Rebekah's home and he tells the brother and the dad and the family about his prayer and that God told him Rebekah is the one. But see, now they have to respond to that. He's told them the whole story, his prayer and his answer. Listen to verse 49. The servant says, now, if you will deal kindly and truly with my master, tell me. And if not, tell me that I may turn to the right hand or to the left. He's saying, it's up to you guys now. I've done everything I can. Rebekah is God's will to be my master's son, Isaac's wife. But it's up to you. What are you going to do? Because I need to know, because I have to respond either way that you choose. Then Laban and Bethuel answered and said, this is very critical here now. Laban and Bethuel said, the thing proceedeth from the Lord. We cannot speak unto thee bad or good. Behold, Rebekah is before thee. Take her and go, and let her be thy master's son's wife, as the Lord has spoken. See, they, even back in the land where Abraham was pulled out of, the people back there at least knew how to find God's will about things and in prayer. And stuff like this. They say the thing proceedeth from the Lord. They accepted the testimony of the servant and everything, his prayer and his answer to prayer. He said, we can't speak into thee bad or good. They knew they better not get in the way, since they knew it was God's will. Behold, Rebekah is before thee. Take her and go, and let her be thy master's son's wife, as the Lord has spoken. And if you read the rest of the chapter 24, it's interesting because They want the servant to stick around for 4 or 5 days. They want to have a big celebration and a big party for Rebecca and all this. And the servant won't have any of it. He says, I'm ready to go home. I need to get this over with. But they said, but let her abide with us a few days so we can, you know, at least 10, and then she shall go. And he said unto them, hinder me not, seeing the Lord is prospering my way. Send me away, and I will go to my master. And they said, we'll call the damsel and inquire of her. And they called Rebekah and said unto her, will thou go with this man? She said, I will go. And they sent her away. They didn't have the party or anything. See, the servant's top priority in all of this was to get to the right girl, find the right girl to be his Isaac's wife, then to get her and go and take her home. And that's what he did. That was even before he, you know, remember eight, he told the family about it. So God's will was the most important thing there to the servant. And this shows how he went about finding the exact woman that God wanted to send back to Isaac. And he fulfilled his part and told the family. And they said, take her and go as the Lord has spoken. Now, see, that's one of the ways the Lord speaks to us. But you got to love the Lord enough and want his will enough to be concerned and you know, pray like this. Now, some people say, well, we have the Holy Spirit nowadays to teach us and everything. Yes, we do. But I've never met anybody yet that says they know perfectly God's will in every situation. So if you have any doubt about your situation, need to pray. Pray in an intelligent way that when God answers you, that he gives you the answer clearly in a way that you'll know that it's his will. Because faith comes by hearing word of God. That servant had faith and knew it was God's will to take Rebekah back. He had no doubts whatsoever. And he did it through a prayer, and God identified it to him. It's time for the next break now, so we'll take a short break here, and I'll be right back, and I'll give you a couple of other examples like that.
We'll be right back with more of God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard Hardin, right here on K98 Talk. Visit Richard's website at rahardin.com. That's the World Wide Web at rahardin.com. At his website, you can see a summary of the 6 books he has written, where purchases may be made. He also has a link to 18 videos on YouTube and several blogs about Christian beliefs. If you prefer, visit amazon.com/Kindle and type in Richard Hardin to see and purchase his books. God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard Hardin can now be heard Monday through Friday mornings at 7 a.m. Central, 8 Eastern, and on Sunday mornings at 6 a.m. Central, 7 Eastern. Join him and let's turn our country back to God. It only takes a spark to start a forest fire. Let's get on fire for the Lord, right here on K98 Talk and the Spark Radio Network.
For past programs of God's Pure Word of Faith, go to www.spreaker.com. That's Spreaker. Spreaker.com. In the search box at the top of the page, enter my name, Richard Hardin, H-A-R-D-I-N, and click on it. A picture with a cross and God's Pure Word of Faith, Richard Hardin, will show up. Click on the picture of the cross. A listing of all the past programs will then show up.
You're listening to God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard Hardin. Richard will guide you through the Bible and help you find God's purpose for your life. Now here's teacher and author Richard Hardin.
Welcome back to God's Pure Word of Faith. Now, I'm on number 8, the instructional prayers for the ways that God speaks to people, and just shared about how God's spoke to Abraham's servant to identify Rebekah as the woman that would be Isaac's wife, and he would take him back and, you know, and that would fulfill then his mission that Abraham had sent him on. This is in Genesis chapter 24. Now, the next one I want to share with you is Numbers chapter 16. You know, when Moses was leading the people out of slavery and leading them across, you know, going to the promised land, he had a lot of people that irritated him and, you know, tried to block him. And in Moses, I mean, in Numbers chapter 16 here, verse 28, finally got down to the point where Dathan, Abram, and Korah were just standing in the way. They had been pestering him all along the way, but now they were going to just, they got in front of him and stopped him, and something had to be done because Moses couldn't go any further the way they were rebelling against him. So in verse 28, Moses said, "Hereby you shall know that the Lord has sent me to do all these works, for I have not done them in my own name." After all the miracles they'd seen God work through Moses and everything, and so many of these people, you know, were trying to reject Moses now. Well, if these men, see, this is a prayer now he's saying it out loud and everything, but he knows God's hearing him and everything. "If these men die the common death of all men, or if they be visited after the visitation of all men, then the Lord has not sent me." He's saying, you know, if they die a normal death and everything like that, then God's not sent me. He said, "But if the Lord make a new thing and the earth open her mouth, swallow them up with all that pertain to them," that means their families and everything they own and everything, "they go down quick into the pit, then ye shall understand that these men have provoked the Lord." You know, that's just a simple thing right there. You know, he's saying, you know, either God, you know, gets rid of you guys and you go down to a pit or something like this and he destroys you, or I'm not God's man. Verse 31, "And it came to pass as Moses had made an end of speaking all these words that the ground clave asunder," or, you know, ground opened up that was under them, "and the earth opened her mouth and swallowed them up and their houses and all the men that pertained to Korah and all their goods." So everybody that was on Korah's side and their goods and everything were swallowed up by the earth, and they and all that pertained to them, their families, went down alive into the pit, and the earth closed upon them, and they perished from among the congregation. And all Israel that was round about them fled at the cry of them, for they said, "Lest the earth swallow us up also." And there came out a fire from the Lord and consumed 250 men that offered incense. Now, that was way of God answering Moses to show the people that Moses was God's man. Now, you'd think that would have satisfied them enough, but if you just flip over the next page now, this is chapter 16, flip over to 17. Now they're griping about Aaron, Moses' brother, the priest. And starting in verse 8 here, 17 verse 8, well, I'll just start in 17 here. It says, "And the Lord spake unto Moses, saying, Speak to the children of Israel, and take every one of them a rod concerning the house of their fathers." That is, in the 12 tribes and everything, each one of them, they would select somebody, and they would take a rod of, you know, a wooden rod, a tree or somewhere like that, and said, "According to the house of their fathers, 12 rods, write thou every man's name on his rod. And thou shalt write Aaron's name upon the rod of Levi. For one rod shall be for the head of the house of their fathers. And thou shalt lay them up in the tabernacle of congregation before the testimony where I will meet with you. And it shall come to pass that the man's rod whom I shall choose shall blossom, and I will make to cleanse from me the murmurings of the children of Israel whereby they murmured against you." And Moses spoke to all of them, and they brought their rods, you know, one from each tribe. And Moses laid up the rods before the Lord in the tabernacle. And it came to pass on the morrow, the next day, Moses went into the tabernacle. Behold, the rod of Aaron for the house of Levi was budded and brought forth buds and bloomed blossoms and yielded almonds. Moses brought out all the rods from the Lord unto the children of Israel, and they looked and took every man his rod. And the Lord said unto Moses, "Bring Aaron's rod again before the testimony to be kept for a token against the rebels, and thou shalt quite take away their murmurings from me that they die not." Now, that rod was also kept in the the temple in the future and everything like that. It was part that was in, I forgot what they called it now, the box that kept the rod, the scripts, the writings and everything like this, in the tabernacle, the Ark of the Lord and everything. Now, so that's the way God answered prayers, you know, and answered things like that to show people, to give them visible signs. See, they weren't the ones praying. Moses was the one praying. Aaron and them were the ones praying. They got the answers from God to show that they were God's people. Now, in Judges chapter 6, we have another example here where you've heard about this probably many times. Gideon, Judges chapter 6, after the angel had come and told Gideon that God was going to use him to save Israel, he went out that night and destroyed the temples of Baal or the altars of Baal, and he built up God's altar and offered sacrifices. Next day, you know, they started chasing around to find out who did it, and there was quite a confusion and everything. But in verses 36, Gideon said unto God, "If thou wilt save Israel with my hand, as thou hast said, behold, I will put a fleece of wool on the floor, and if thy dew is on the fleece only, it be dry all the earth beside, then shall I know that thou hast saved Israel by my hand, as thou say." See, he had doubt. He was praying in a way here that when God answered his prayer, it would encourage him and let him know God's will. Now, it says, "And it was so, for he rose early the next morning and thrust the fleece together and wring the dew out of the fleece a bowl full of water, yet the ground was dry." Now, he was just wondering now, maybe somebody tricked, you know. Anyway, he wasn't fully satisfied. So Gideon said to God in verse 39, "Let not thy anger be hot against me, and I will speak but this once. Let me prove, I pray thee, but this once with the fleece. Let it now be dry only on the fleece, and upon all the ground let it be wet." And God did so that night. It was dry upon the fleece only, and there was dew all over the ground. But see, God answered him. He wasn't playing games with God and testing something. He had doubt, and he just wanted to know for sure. And, you know, God doesn't want us to run out doing things if we have doubt. Somehow or another, pray and seek the Lord till you get confirmation from God and know something's his will, because you can't go in faith if you have doubt. Faith comes by hearing the word of God. If you haven't heard from God, you still have doubt. God will bless an ounce of faith, because that means you've heard from God. But he won't bless an ounce of doubt, because that means you haven't heard from God. See, the dividing point is hearing God's word and knowing it's his word. Then you accept his word to faith. Now, Gideon did this. And if you go and read the story in Judges chapter 7, God used Gideon and 300 men to rout the Midianites, which were tens of thousands and stuff like this, you know, just huge army like that. God used Gideon and 300 men to do that. So let's see, there's another example here. I hope I have time for this. It's kind of funny, this one, in 1 Samuel 6. Find 1 Samuel 6 real quick. We all always got to do things real quick, especially when you're on the air. 1 Samuel chapter 6, the Philistines had captured the Ark of God, and they had moved it around from city to city, and everywhere it went, the people of the city got sick with boils and, you know, just terrible, you know, infections and things like this, all kind of them and everything. And they started to move them to one city. And the people had heard of what was going on, and this was, I think, here in verse 16, it says, down here in verse 9, they had got so tired of so many people getting sick, and this one city had refused to let them bring the Ark of God to that city because they had heard what had been happening. So they said, we've got to send that back over to the Israelites, get it out of our country. And they decided they would put a, you know, a lot of jewelry and things like this on it as gifts to the Lord, you know, to maybe if it's what was going on, if it's really the God causing them to get sick from this. But they wanted to know if it was God. So this is how they determined. They said, and they took the Ark of the Lord and said, lay up on the cart and put the jewels of gold, which you returned to him for a trespass offering, in a coffer by the side, and send it away that it may go. Now, listen how they do this, though. And see, if it goes up by the way of its own coast to Beth-Shemesh, then he hath done this great evil. But if not, then we'll know that it was not his hand that smote us, but it was just chance that it happened. Now, what happened now then? The men did so. They took two milk cows, tied them to the cart, and shut their calves up at home. Now, what, you know, cows don't like to be separated from their calves. The calves don't like to be separated from their mothers. So they took two milk cows that had just had calves and tied them to the cart. And they laid the Ark of the Lord upon the cart and a coffer with, you know, the gold and images and things like that that they were sending back as a trespass offering. And the cows took the straight way to Beth-Shemesh and went along the highway, lowing as they went. And listen to this now. And turned not aside to the right hand or to the left. And the lords of the Philistines went after them to the all the way to the border of Israel. And when the people over there in Israel were reaping, you know, the wheat and the harvest and everything, they lift up their eyes and saw the ark. They rejoiced to see it. So they got it back. But the Philistines, though, they saw that these cows just left their young, you know, their calves, didn't even look back, didn't turn to the right or the left. They just went, carried that straight back. See, they knew that was a miracle of the Lord and that God had done that to them, because of the way they'd set it up and everything. So it really wasn't necessarily what you'd call a prayer, but it was just a way to say, well, God can show us his presence is this. And it did, because they got rid of that thing, because everywhere they took it, God was making everybody sick. So he just got it out of there. Well, one more. This will be in, let's see, what is it? 1 Samuel 14. Verses 9 through 14. 1 Samuel 14, King Saul, priest, and his son, are surrounded on top of a mountain. And the problem here is that the Philistines are down at the bottom of the mountain. And there's a very narrow pass up and down that mountain to where only one person can go. So the Israelites can't come down, because if they come down one at a time, the Philistines are going to kill them. The Philistines can't come up to get to them, because if they do, they'll be coming up one at a time and the Israelites will kill them. So here, the children of Israel up there surrounded, and it's King Saul. There's a priest. And the reason they mention is a priest, and because he's not seeming to be concerned about seeking God's will or anything. And the Philistines are gathered at the bottom. Well, let's see, 1 Samuel 14, verse 9. Oh, yeah, okay, now here we are. Jonathan, King Saul's son, is with him. And he's kind of tired of, you know, sitting around doing nothing. So Jonathan said to the young man who was his armor bearer, says, come, let us go over to the garrison of these uncircumcised Philistines. It may be that the Lord will work for us, for there is no restraint to the Lord to save by many or by few. And his armor bearer said to him, do all that is in thy heart to thee. Behold, I am with thee according to thy heart. Now listen to what Jonathan said. Then Jonathan said, behold, we'll pass over into these men and we'll discover ourselves unto them. So they were going to go down the mountain to the Philistines. If they say to us, tarry until we come to you, then we'll stand still in our place and not go up to them. But if they say, come up to us, then we'll go up, for the Lord has delivered them into our hand, and this shall be a sign to us. See, now what he's saying here is that he's going to trust that God's going to speak through these Philistines and tell them to stay in their place or to fight. If God speaks through that Philistine and says, tarry until we come to you, they will know then that's God telling them to stay where they are in hiding. But if God causes that Philistine to say, come up to us, someone, come up to us, those four words, then we'll know that God's going to give us a victory. See, Jonathan was giving God a way to show either stay there hiding or fight. One or the other, you know, because if they stayed up there hiding, sooner or later, they're going to run out of food and water and stuff, and they're going to be, you know, killed anyway. So now, verse 11, and both of them discovered themselves in the garrison of Philistines. They went down. Now, listen to the greeting that the Philistines give them. It's kind of a smart aleck greeting. The Philistines said, behold, the Hebrews come forth out of the holes where they've hid themselves. And the men of the garrison answered Jonathan, his armor bearer, and said, come up to us, and we'll show you a thing. See, kind of a smart aleck greeting. Come up to us, and we'll show you a thing. But what they didn't know, that was God speaking through him, controlling his language and his voice, telling Jonathan, I'm giving you the victory. So the Philistine said, come up to us and we'll show you a thing. Well, Jonathan said to his armor bearer, come up after me, for the Lord has delivered them in the hand of Israel. So he didn't wait to go back and tell his dad and anybody, you know, hey, God just told me he's going to give us a victory, anything like that. He and his armor bearer, next verse, Jonathan jumped up upon his hands, upon his feet, and his armor bearer after him, and they fell before Jonathan's armor bearer, slew after him. And that first slaughter, which Jonathan's armor bearer made, was about 20 men within were a half acre of land. So Jonathan didn't wait to go back talk to his dad about it and say, hey, God just told me he's going to, you know, give us a victory. Let's go down and fight some land. He just jumped up and attacked the whole army, him and his armor bearer. And within a half acre of land, they had killed 20 of the enemy, and it caused such a fuss among the enemy and everything like that. They got confused and they started even just killing each other and everything. And there was so much noise and everything from it that a lot of other Israelites joined in that were down below, you know, in that area. The guys up on the mountain, they joined in. So God answered and showed Jonathan, the armor bearer here, exactly what to do. Now see, the reason I'm sharing is that because we have the same God. And God wants us to know without a doubt his will. He doesn't want us just running off doing things and like hoping it's his will or, you know, something like this and claiming it's his will. He wants us to seek him until he can show us his will and then go in faith. Because see, going in doubt and not knowing something's God's will doesn't glorify God. Faith comes by hearing the word of God, but we got to have his pure word and know it's God speaking to us. Then when we go, see, God's going with us. And we'll be going in the strength of God's power. It'll be God doing the performance of the different things that we need to do. I've always heard, you know, if God opens a door or something like that, we shouldn't try to push doors open for God. Because if we push a door open, then we got to hold it open. But if God opens a door, he holds it open. Now, we're about out of time this morning, and first thing we need to hear from God as we grow up is that we're sinners. We've got to accept that. If we reject we're sinners, we can't get saved, but we got to accept that we're sinners. For by grace are you saved through faith. Accepting God's word, you're a sinner, then accepting that Jesus is our answer for our sins. He says, you know, the gift of God that brings salvation appeared to all men. He's going to, you know, tell us about that. We're sinners. Christ is the answer for our sin. Then we must humble ourselves and turn to him with all our heart. And that's what he expects all of us to do. There is something we must do for salvation. There is something we must do to receive grace. And that is humble ourselves, admit we're a sinner, and say, Lord, please forgive me. Send your spirit to come into my heart, and I commit my life to you. See, we have to make the choice. He won't force his way in our heart. But it's not his will that any perish. It's his will that we all turn to him in repentance and invite him to come in our heart. And he makes it to where we have to make the choice, our free will choice, and he'll honor it. Some people right now probably listening know that they need to receive Christ as their personal Lord and Savior, but they haven't done it yet. Well, in Hebrews chapter 4, verse 2, it says, "For unto us was the gospel preached as well as unto them, but the word preached did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them that heard it." Now, what this means is you've heard and know the gospel. People have said, you know, "I'll wait till I get out of college. I'll wait till I get married. I'll wait till I get things straightened out in my life." But see, you'll never get things straightened out in your life. The devil won't let you. He'll keep things being confused and everything. And once you turn from the Lord, once you know you're a sinner and need Christ, that is a time you need to turn to the Lord, because see, the devil is going to really have advantage in your life if you reject God's love that he just knowingly offers to you and you recognize it and turn from it. Don't do that. It's too scary. Eternity is a long time to have to suffer for something that Jesus has already paid the price for. He's already suffered for us and paid the price. Turn to him with all your heart and just, "Lord, please forgive me. Come into my heart and save me. I commit my life to you." Now, in 2 Corinthians 3:16, it says, "When the heart of man turns to the Lord, the veil of separation is lifted." It doesn't have to be certain exact words, but you've got to, in the tent of your heart, just say, "Oh, God, I need you." You know, a drunk laying on the side of the street could say, "Oh, God, help." You know, and his heart turning to God and everything. God hears heart language, and he'll hear an answer. But we've got to make the choice, and nobody else can make the choice from us. You might have had one of the greatest preachers on earth in your family. Might have been your uncle or might have been your dad or something like that, but that don't make you a Christian. You've got to make your personal choice yourself to respond and ask God's forgiveness of your sins, invite him to come into your heart, and I encourage you to do it today. Next week, I'm going to be sharing about mercy, grace, and charity, God's love to us. And again, the only way we can respond positively to him, though, is through acceptance and obedience to his word, to faith. Faith comes by hearing, hearing the word of God, but only if we accept and obey. And so today, let me encourage you, do that. Turn to the Lord. Put that to your top priority. If you do not recognize that you have received the changed heart, Ezekiel 36:26, God says, "A new heart also will I give you. A new spirit will I put within you. I'll take away the stony heart out of your flesh, give you a heart of flesh, and I'll put my spirit in you." Now that's going to be a drastic change in your heart. If you do not remember ever turning to God and just crying out to him for salvation, do it. Because just joining a church and getting baptized, that does not make you a Christian. You've got to, you know, turn to the Lord and receive the changed heart. You must be born of the Spirit. Jesus says, you must be born again, born to the Spirit of God in you. Galatians 4:6 says, "And because your sons, God has sent forth the Spirit of his Son into your hearts, crying, Daddy, Father, Abba, Father. Wherefore, you're no more a servant, but a son. If a son, then heir of God through Christ." See, it's when his spirit comes in us, we become a child of God. We become a Christian. And Romans 8:9 says, "Now, if any man have not the spirit of Christ, he is none of his. So either you've received the spirit of Christ in your heart, been baptized into the body of Christ, or you're none of his." Now, we're all born his creation, but we're not his children until we receive the Spirit of Christ into our heart. And now I want to add on this message at the tail end of this broadcast today. I had to, you know, change some commercials in the program because they were outdated and everything. But now this faith test today is to accept and believe God's word and receive it into your heart, into our heart. Now, I'm going to share some scriptures now that say God does not know everything. Now, I know that's right opposite what's taught in our society. That's right opposite of what you've heard. But I'm going to share with you some scriptures, and it'll be up to you and between you and God whether you accept these scriptures or not. Okay, now, there's two areas. The first one is about our forgiven sins. In Isaiah 43:25, God says, "I, even I, am he that blotteth out thy transgressions for mine own sake." See, he's doing it for his own sake. "And I will not remember thy sins." He's saying he's going to forgive and blot them out and not remember them. So that means for our forgiven sins, he doesn't know them. He's forgotten them. Also in Hebrews 10:17, that was Old Testament, but in Isaiah, but in Hebrews 10:17, it says, "And their sins and iniquities will I remember no more." See, so any forgiven sins, he does not remember. Therefore, it's settled. God does not know everything. In Hebrews 8:12, "For I will be merciful to their unrighteousness, and their sins and their iniquities will I remember no more." Then Jeremiah 31:34, excuse me, "Saith the Lord, for I will forget their iniquity, and I will remember their sin no more." I will forgive their iniquity, I mean, and I will remember their sin no more. So see, this is one area. He's promised to forgive and to forget our sins. So you can't say God knows everything if God knows how somehow or another to remove all of that from his remembrance and tells us that he's forgiven and forgotten our sins. Now that's one area. Is there possibly another area that God has chosen to not exert his, you know, supreme authority of being able to know something about us? Yes, there is. Let me read you three verses now in Jeremiah where God himself says that he didn't know something. Jeremiah chapter 7, verse 3. Says, "And they have built high places at Topheth, which is in the valley of the son of Hinnom, to burn their sons and their daughters in the fire, which I commanded them not, neither came it into my heart." It says, "neither came it into my heart." God says here that they were so sinful that it hadn't even come into his heart. In Jeremiah 19:5, God says, "They have built also the high places of Baal to burn their sons with fire for burnt offerings to Baal, which I commanded not, nor spake it, neither came it into my mind." He's saying that they were so evil in what they were doing, it had not even come into his mind. He hadn't thought about it. In Jeremiah 32:35, says, "And they built high places to Baal, which are in the valley of the son of Hinnom, to cause their sons and their daughters to pass through the fire unto Molech, which I commanded them not, neither came it into my mind that they should do this abomination to cause Judah to sin." Now, three times here in the book of Jeremiah, God says that the children of Israel had become so evil and they had done things that he had never even thought about it. It had never come into his heart, never come into his mind. Now, are we to believe that? Well, see, God is the one that makes up the rules. And he's not just sitting there, you know, setting things in front of us that we have to go through in predestination. Now, he has predestined each of us to a holy calling. Like in 2 Timothy 1:9 says, "If he saved us and called us to a holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace created in Christ Jesus before the world began." But see, he doesn't make us do that. He tries to lead us with his love to make the choices. He doesn't know what choice we'll make until we make the choice. Now, God knows what will happen when we accept him and his word. He knows what will happen when we reject him. But he doesn't know which we're going to make until we make the choice. He gives us a free will to make that choice. And the devil does not want people to realize how important that is because, you know, we're not predestined to heaven or hell. The things that are going to happen this afternoon, tonight, and tomorrow are not set in concrete that they're going to happen regardless. See, we make the choices. And God is walking with us as Christians all the way, trying to get us to make the choices according to his desires and everything. But he's trying to get us to follow him out of love. He's also trying to draw lost people, like it says in Romans chapter 2 verse 4. He says he blesses lost people to draw them to repentance. See, he's trying to always draw people to make the right choice. God in his love forgets our sins. He doesn't hang on to those memories of how bad we were or things evil like that we've done. And he gives total free will and doesn't know what choices until after we make them. He knows what will happen when we accept his word, and he knows what will happen when we reject his word. But he doesn't know which we will do until we make that choice. Now, there's so many more scriptures like that tell the same thing, and our ministers aren't telling us that and preaching it across the nation, that God loves us and that God, you know, wants us to, you know, turn to him because of our love, not because of what he's forcing us to do or something like that. In Exodus chapter 16, verse 4, God said to Moses, "Then said the Lord to Moses, Behold, I'll rain bread from heaven for you, and the people shall go out and gather a certain rate every day, that I may prove them." See, he's wanting to prove them to see what's in their heart. He says, "That I may prove them whether they will walk in my law or not." See, he's saying here, he wants to, you know, get them to, you know, learn to obey him. And he's going to prove them like that, but he wants to know. In Abraham, you know, when Abraham, God told him to go sacrifice Isaac, his only son, he got up there. When God saw that he was going to, you know, actually kill Isaac and perform the, you know, the sacrifice, then God had that angel call out to him in Genesis 22, verses 11 through 12. "Abraham, Abraham," he said. And Abraham said, "Here am I." And God said, "Lay not thy hand upon the lad, neither do thou anything unto him. For now I know that thou fearest God, seeing thou hast not withheld my son and thine only son from me." Now, I've heard a lot of messages about this through the years, and it's very interesting how the preachers can twist that all around and everything and say that it says something else. But God is saying here, "Now I know that thou fearest me." See, and that's what God was doing. He was testing Abraham there to see if Abraham would truly listen and follow him. And there's so many other scriptures like this in the Bible where God tested his people and rained down manna and everything to see what they would do if they would obey, because they were only supposed to get the manna from, you know, enough for one day, except the day before the Sabbath they could get enough for 2 days. And if they did get more manna than they were supposed to get, the next morning it would stink and smell, and they'd be able to know then who it was that was disobeying the Lord. And just all through the scriptures, if you look through here and see these, God, you know, well, like in Ezekiel 3:20, it says again, "His righteousness which he has done shall not be remembered." See, when people were righteous in the Old Testament and they turned from it, God wouldn't even remember that if they turned and became evil. So, well, again, in Hebrews 8:12, "For I will be merciful to their unrighteousness, and their sins and their iniquities I will remember no more." So he forgives and forgets our sins and doesn't hold them against us. But then in Jeremiah again, "They've built high places of Topheth, which is the valley of the son of Hinnom, to burn their sons and their daughters in the fire, which I commanded them not, neither came it into my heart." You know, in Jeremiah, God says, "These are the thoughts I have for thee, that thou prosper and be in health." And, you know, he's thinking good things for us. He's not setting up or planning things that this time tomorrow somebody's going to, you know, have this wreck, or this time tomorrow somebody's going to shoot this person or stab this person or things like this. He's trying to work us and draw us into his path, because the angel of the Lord is around those that protect, you know, that fear him and delivers them. See, in his shield of protection, like Psalms 91, where it says, "He that abideth in the shadow of the Almighty shall..." Well, I just lost that verse, but in Psalms 91, well, it's too late now for me to get the verse for you, but he says, "Shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty." He wants to draw us into that protection he has for us. So look these scriptures up and Good day. God bless you.
Visit Richard's website at rahardin.com. That's the World Wide Web at rahardin.com. At his website, you can see a summary of the 6 books he has written, where purchases may be made. He also has a link to 18 videos on YouTube and several blogs about Christian beliefs. If you prefer, visit amazon.com/Kindle and type in Richard Hardin to see and purchase his books.